Okay, so our speaker this evening is Professor Alejandro Rico-Guevara. He's an assistant professor at the University of Washington in the Department of Biology. And he will be presenting some of his research findings on hummingbird evolutionary adaptations. He will talk about hummingbird bill weapons. And some of his background, he is the curator of ornithology at Burke Museum. And as an undergraduate, he attended the Universidad Nacional de Colombia. He received his PhD from UConn, University of Connecticut, and as a Fulbright scholar. And he carried out postdoc research at UC Berkeley. He has received the Patalka Award for Excellence in Research from the International Society of Behavioral Ecology. His research has been featured in the New York Times, National Geographic, and he has been in 6 nature documentaries and various TV programs and numerous articles in peer-reviewed publications. So that's just some of the things that he's done. So I will turn it over to you, Alejandro, and thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Carla. Thank you for inviting me and for all of you to be here. This is truly an honor, and I'm gonna share some of our work that we do in the lab here. So let me start this and make sure that it's all going properly, and then we can get to it. Is this working? Everybody seeing this properly? Thumbs up.
Looks good.
All right, thank you. Please feel free to interrupt me at any moment. If you have questions, just unmute yourself, and I'll just steer the conversation towards, you know, like what we want to get out of it. Otherwise, I'll just, you know, keep talking and explaining things, but it would be good to have your feedback as well. All right, so I entitled this talk "To Feed or to Fight." That's a daily question that hummingbirds ask themselves. We work on different aspects of hummingbird biology and other nectar feeding animals at the lab. We are starting at the University of Washington. Our lab is called Behavioral Ecophysics, and that's located at the Department of Biology here at UW. And I am also a curator of birds at the Burke Museum. So thank you. I have to thank many people for supporting my research, especially to the World Helping Endowed Assistant Professorship, the Washington Research Foundation, and many people that have participated in the work I do. With that, I'd like to describe a little bit of what is ecophysics. So it's just merging the laws that everything in the universe has to obey with what is important for the living things, so the ecology part. And I do ecophysics by, for instance, getting 3D reconstructions of structures involved in feeding and flying, such as bills and wings, at the Burke Museum. And then I study captive birds with electronic devices here, with the aim to then transform them into portable ones to use in the field. I do this at the Department of Biology here. And then I translate those insights from the lab to many different species of hummingbirds in Colombia. We're lucky that there is the country with most species of hummingbirds and of birds in general in the world. So we are having a blast there. To contextualize these very broadly, to pass on your genes in this evolutionary game that all living things play, you have to two main things. One is to survive, and another one is to reproduce. And that's in hummingbird terms translated into feeding efficiently and fighting successfully. And that's going to be what I'm going to talk about, the different parts of the talk. So first, nectar intake biophysics. And this is important because everything in hummingbirds' lives from dawn to dusk, and also in their ecology and evolution, revolves around drinking nectar. So the question is, how do they do it? And to answer that question, we need to design special feeders, because when a hummingbird is drinking from a flower, whatever happens in the interaction is hidden inside the flower. So imagine this hermit feeding this heliconia, and then inside that flower, inside that heliconia bract, there is a flower with nectar at the bottom. So we design feeders to mimic those shapes and the content of nectar in the flowers. And then we train hummingbirds to drink from them. And that has the advantage that we can film them with high-speed cameras to slow down all the process and all the motion and study each step of the process with a resolution that hasn't been done before. So, to split that up and start looking into each of the parts of this process, we need to understand the morphology. So how does a hummingbird tongue look like? And they are forked, split like snakes' tongues, if you wish. They are solid. The first half of them is totally solid, so they don't work as straws. And this is a three-dimensional representation of a hummingbird. So this is a micro CT scan. And I'm gonna start cutting through it. So the advantage of these techniques is that they allow you to see inside of the hummingbird. And you can see here the bill and the tongue inside the bill. And we can start looking at different structures. So to give you an idea of how tiny these structures are, this is a grain of salt. So always take everything with it. But these things are really tiny. So I'm gonna focus now on this region here, the actual tongue. And we're gonna make a zoom and overlaying some histology techniques. And I'm gonna have references here. For instance, this is the how thick a piece of paper is, just normal paper. So these are really thin tongue walls. So the tongue is not only tiny, but it's made of really thin films. And now we're gonna zoom in those films. So these tongue walls are made of keratin. This is a keratinized band. And I'm clicking in the wrong portion. Okay, so if I click outside, then we're gonna zoom in into that layer of keratin and how the cells are organized in that layer of keratin. It is a brick wall in a way that the cells are perfectly aligned in an overlapping way to give some pretty amazing properties. And then when you really push the electron microscope that we're using in this technique, we find that the material that these tongues are made of is beta keratin, which is the same material that the feathers are made of. So this confers the tongues very interesting properties. And now, you know, zooming out and moving on, I'm gonna show you a piece of video on it.
In just a second or so, a hummer has lapped up all the liquid the little chamber offers and moves on in a constant dance among the flowers. But how is it possible for a tongue thinner than a fishing line to perform such a feat so fast? Inside his workshop, Alejandro is creating something special. He's mounting a real flower onto one of his clear feeding tubes with a cutout on the side, a window to the inside of the flower. Now, with high-speed macro photography, we see something truly new. Hummingbirds' long tongues have forked tips that open as the tongue dips into the nectar. A fringe of tiny filaments uncurls along the edges of the open tips, creating grooves that spring open, filling the tongue with nectar. It's a structure science has never seen before, and it's an incredibly efficient technology for picking up a liquid.
And the reason why this is so efficient is because, you know, now going back to those thin walls, when the tongue is pushed inside the nectar, and now we're gonna take a look from the inside of the nectar inside the flower, you can see how this structure relaxes and all the fringes are open inside the nectar. But when the bird pulls the tongue outside of the nectar, they close up. And this is all because of the interaction between the surface tension of the liquid and the tongue properties. So this is what happens inside the nectar. But a lot of time, there is a space between the nectar and the bill. So the question is now, what does the rest of the tongue do? And here you can see how when they are depleting the nectar, you need to account for that portion that is still to be filled with nectar. So how do they do that? And to understand this process, we now are in this particular experiment, we're using red dye, which is the same dye that you know, people use for food. So it's not harming them, but usually when people sell these red dyes in stores, is the hummingbirds don't need red nectar to drink from. It's just that the red attracts them, so that's why they sell it that way, but they don't need them red dyed. Anyhow, going back to the experiment, we use red dye because then we can see the nectar moving through the transparent tongue, and this is how it looks. I want you to pay attention to how the tongue fills with nectar, but also how the hummingbird squeezes the tongue when it's going out and then releases the pressure when the tongue is going back in. So is the bill tip which is operating the tongue. And this is what links what we have learned from the morphology, especially that these thin tongue walls are easily foldable, and that the architecture, that brick wall composition, and the beta keratin make it a non-stretchable structure. So when you have those two properties combined, is great for storing elastic energy, like this pole vaulting. And that's what happens when the hummingbirds are drinking. The bill tips compress that structure that bends the wall, storing potential energy. And once the tongue tip touches the nectar, then all of that energy is released and they spring up and filling with the nectar. So here is that now below, you can see a zoomed in version of the video that I showed with the red dye. This is the bill tip and the nectar is here. And now I'm gonna play it for you to see what happens. We call this process expansive filling because first the tongue travels empty until it touches the nectar. And then now I'm gonna keep playing the video. And then soon after it has contacted the nectar, it fills by expanding the internal cavity of the tongue. So that's why it's called expansive filling. And it's amazing that this process happens in only a few milliseconds. So that's why this is also so efficient and so fast. It doesn't require muscular action to change the shape of the tongue. And it's tremendously rapid. Okay, so the comparison, so it's like a hundredth of a second. It's pretty fast. Okay, so now we have nectar in the tongue, but that's not the end of the story. Next, you have to get the nectar outside of the tongue. And how do they do that? So we discovered that the bill tips actually act as ringers, squeezing the nectar out of the tongue and keeping it inside the bill. And I'm not gonna have time to go into the details, but there are pretty interesting structures inside of the bill tips to make this process happen very smoothly. But what I can tell you right now is that to feed efficiently, hummingbirds need these flexible bill edges. As you see here in this, again, this CT scan, these edges of the bill called tomia are very flexible. They need these concave inner surfaces, sort of like having two spoons against each other to clean that tongue out of nectar. And that makes blunt bill tips with a good seal to keep all the liquid inside. Okay, so this is to remember. Next, when the nectar is inside of the bill tip, then they still have to move it all the way to where they can swallow it. And to move it to the throat, another piece of information is that hummingbirds have these flaps at the base of the tongue called tongue wings. And that the tongue base can be tracked when you track the tongue tip because the whole length doesn't change. So with those pieces of information, we can get videos, dorsal and side videos, like top and side views. And we use backlighting techniques to see through the bills. And once you see through the bills, you can start tracking the nectar inside. You can see in the top some bubbles moving. So this was pretty exciting to get to this point. Okay, so with all of that, we can make quantitative reconstructions to figure out how the nectar moves inside of the bill. And here in the side view, we can see how the tips separate and the base. And what we find is that the whole bill and tongue operates as a dynamic piston mechanism. That's the working name. So if you have better suggestions, we're open to them. here, the tongue is actually dragging that aliquot of fluid backwards. And then the bill is opening and closing and this is clear in inside view, to accommodate for that load of nectar moving inside the bill. Okay, so finally, we understand how they drink nectar. So we can put all of the pieces back together and summarize by saying that there is this fantastic fluid trap at the tip of the tongue, then the rest of it fills by expansive filling. The bill tip rings the tongue, and then that nectar is moved through a dynamic piston mechanism. So we can put a check mark on the biomechanics. And this is important because this is gonna determine many, many aspects of the experiments and how we understand how build change shapes and we can move on to the energetics performance, which is the next portion of the talk. So the real question that we wanna try to answer, and this is why we focus on ecophysics, is what is the connection between the mechanisms and evolution? When you see a flower in nature and a hummingbird visiting it, they really are in a hurry. Like if you blinked, you miss that visit. And that's how long it usually takes. It's very, very fast. So to study this and to move more towards the field data, we design these high-speed camera traps. And with these new mechanisms, we were able to slow down the hummingbirds now visiting in the flower and actually getting the nectar. And we could see the nectar inside of the flower again with backlighting techniques. So here, this was a part of a paper that we recently published. And the cool thing about doing this is that these are, you know, wild animals and you can start quantifying things on those videos too. So here you can tell how much nectar was originally in the flower and how many licks it takes for the hummingbird to deplete it. And that can be done in many different contexts by different species of hummingbirds. You can measure all of these parameters that ultimately are gonna give us information to understand how they should behave, at least in nature. And with that, the summary of all of that is how much energy they can get from the nectar. But they are also spending energy, and they're expending energy by hovering mostly. We can also calculate then that side of the equation. So the power output from the wings, we can take measurements in collections for different specimens. And we are lucky that here at the Berkeley Museum, there is the largest bird wing collection in the world. So taking advantage of that, we make these predictions from aerodynamic models, taking aspects, taking measurements from the wings themselves, and then studying the kinematics of their flight. So to study the kinematics of their flight, we train them to feed from different flowers oriented at different positions, with different concentrations, etc. So this little hummingbird circus is important because in nature they get that from the flowers they feed from, all of that variation. So I'm gonna show briefly this bit of the documentary that explains what is the connection between the energy that we are trying to make. Okay, so here we go.
The trees and plants are soaking up the sun's energy. By the magic of photosynthesis, they convert sunlight into glucose energy, in other words, sugar. You can see it and even taste it. You can actually taste the energy from the sun.
Plants act like batteries. capturing the sun's energy as glucose. And in this forest, one animal can't get enough of the stuff. The hummingbird.
Hummingbirds can move their wings over 100 times a second. You can feel how much energy they're spending just by being there.
This frenzy of activity is fueled by glucose-rich nectar.
This is a device that from the front, it looks like a flower. So a hummingbird comes and it feeds from it. There is one. It's going back and forth. Come on, you can do it. Okay, so now it's drinking.
The device measures the nectar the bird is drinking and the oxygen it is breathing.
We calculate the energy intake from the nectar and the energy output from the oxygen, and we can calculate very accurately how much energy the bird is using.
And this energetics framework is important because it's a window to their behavior and to the decision making that they have to make in nature all the time. So these experiments with volunteers allow us also to assess how much different species can drink nectar and how fast. So now focusing on that part of how fast and how we measure that. Here, for instance, at UW, we are working with an undergrad that is helping us to now track the meniscus displacement and the leaking distances using machine vision. So this is the next step in the process in which we can have many videos that will be processed automatically to get these parameters across different species and different nectar characteristics to understand all of the variation that is found in nature. And again, this would allow us to calculate the energy and how they modulate behaviorally that nectar intake. Okay, so now this is our main framework of hummingbird ecophysics. And this is important because net energy gain is the link and the currency that animals use in nature to make decisions, which is what links all of those biomechanics that we study with the coevolution between plants and hummingbirds. So all of these famous examples in which there are extreme matches between the curvature, the length, the positioning, you know, in the of the reproductive parts. These are South American birds that we study in Colombia, but this is a North American bird. This happens in your backyards all the time. And all of that is determined by those benefits between what the plant receives versus what the birds receive. So now this is important because what does all of these have to do with how they fight? And this is the next part of the talk. So to get into that, I had this picture here, and at first, without any warning, it would be hard to tell why is that there. Like, it doesn't look like a hummingbird at all, but it actually is. That's the bill tip of a hummingbird called the toothbill hummingbird. And there are some hummingbirds that have these crazy bill tips. And the question is why? Why all that we have talked about so far is fine-tuning the bill shape to extract nectar, why would you have those crazy and bizarre bill tips. So what are the additional pressures that shape the bill morphology? And again, a brief intro to describe our findings on that front very, very succinctly. So here we go.
The hummingbird and the flower. It's a perfect pair. Just look how the long, slender bill matches the shape of the flower. But as anyone with a popular hummingbird feeder knows, these birds are also furious fighters. The Aztecs knew it. Their god of war was a hummingbird. Warriors were known to wear their feathers into battle. They were so on target. Scientists working in Colombia have found that for some of these birds, evolution has actually turned their beaks into swords. To study these birds, researchers set up high-speed cameras in the rainforest. They recorded interactions that looked like dueling fencers. The hummingbirds had some pretty good moves. There's the stab, where the bird charges its rival like a jousting knight, or the feint and parry, where the birds fight it out beak to beak until one tosses the other aside. And of course, the pinch and pluck, where the birds use their strong bills to bite and rip out feathers. All hummingbirds fight, but in these birds, the males had beaks that had been radically reshaped. These were thicker, more rigid, often hooked at the end, and in some cases, they had jagged points like rows of teeth. These weaponized bills were much less efficient at feeding. The hooked bill and the serrations both interfered with the tongue. But then again, a weaponized bill allowed the males to control access to the flowers. It doesn't matter how well you drink if you don't let anyone else near the nectar. At one time, it seemed like bill shape was all about matching the flower. Now, it's pretty clear, a bird does not live by nectar alone.
So this is the new frontier of our research, and this is what we are looking into now more deeply. And then just to recall and to link these two sides of the coin, all of what we discussed, that the hummingbirds needed to feed efficiently, is sort of like counteracted by the adaptations that we see in these bills adapted to fight. So instead of flexible, they have stiff bill serrations and tips. Instead of concave, they have these conical, sharp bill tips. And all of that configuration actually leaves a gap between the bill tips that is not the best thing that you can use to squeeze the tongue, right? Like instead of spoons, now you have a couple of ice peckers or something that would make it challenging. So interestingly, these modified bill tips here in black, in the little black circles in this family tree of the hummingbirds, with the white circles being the normal configuration. So most of the hummingbirds have the normal, and only a few species, some of the clades, many species in a given clade, but it has appeared independently many times across the phylogeny. So these little fighters, these little sorrows are widely spread across hummers. And this is a more specific analysis, which is called ancestral reconstruction analysis of the family tree. And this is looking specifically into the serrations. So in black, the ones that are backwardly directed, and there are transitions between those, like forward directed, the ones that squeeze well the nectar are in most hummingbirds. And then there are transitions between the states. But now we're understanding this better, and we want to know what are the forces, the evolutionary forces that give rise to weapons in birds in general. So for that, we expanded our research to all birds in general. I took this picture right after this bird flew right over my head And it was because I was too close to its nest. And when I saw these wing spurs, I just backed off. There are many different kinds of spurs in birds. But that takes me to the last bit of the talk, which is this new concept that we developed called intrasexually selected weapons. The main questions here are, what are specialized weapons that animals use to fight same-sex conspecific, and what are the evolutionary trends on them? And to answer these, we made a huge, very time-consuming literature review of all what was available. And we published that these a couple of years ago. We were, you know, not done with all the new papers, but we just had to, you know, finish. And this is the tree in which, in black branches, you can see all the taxa that have these weapons, and all the sister clades that don't. It's interesting that the main trends. So again, I'm not going to spend too much time talking about these, but the main trends were that these weapons are exaggerated in non-hunting animals, such as herbivores, or small prey hunters, meaning relative to body size. So for instance, hummingbirds are hunters because they hunt little spiders or little wasps and flies. So these are some of those examples in which the weapons are very exaggerated. And these are usually more enlarged in males, but not always. So interestingly enough, in all of the cases of evolution of these weapons in nature, there are only two cases in which is the female rather than the male that has these exaggerated weapons. And one is jacanas, and one is bees. So we can talk about that later if you're interested, but for the sake of time, I'll move on to like why studying all of these is so rewarding and important. And one of the aspects of our research that is very important is that we can communicate the huge importance of doing science and of all of these museum and field research across the globe. And now that we live in this virtual world, this is even more important. So communicating science is a big part of what we do. And to me, like one of the most rewarding aspects of communicate science is doing it for kids. The newer generations are the ones that are gonna have, you know, a saying in changing our future. So this, for instance, is a page from a kids magazine in which they're using our research and how they fight and how they fly to teach math, for instance. And then there are we also have partnerships with education and other learning platforms to teach about all the wonders of hummingbirds as ambassadors of nature, because we firmly believe that, this is one of my favorite phrases, and I just wanna finish with that, my talk today, and open it for questions. We are convinced that we can only conserve what we love, and we will only really love what we truly understand. And to do that, we need to teach that to the new generations. So with that, yeah, thank you so much for your time, and I'll be super happy to answer questions. Thank you so much.
OK.
Thank you so much. That was really wonderful, Alejandro. Really, really fascinating.
Yeah, my pleasure. Let me stop sharing. And I can reshare if you know, we want to talk about parts of the talk, but yes.
Okay. Let's see, we have a number of questions here. I'll just read through them. Let's see, quite a few. Sorry, gotta go through a few here. okay, I went all the way back to the sightings here. from Kim Nelson, thank you for the clarification about the use of red dye in the nectar. Do you also use a 1:4 sugar water ratio in your experiments, or do you offer a higher sugar ratio to attract more of them?
We usually use 1:4. And we also have some experiments in which we evaluate their preferences of different concentrations and how fast they can drink nectar from different concentrations. But those are like particular experiments. Like in our general research, we keep it like around 20%. Yeah.
Another question from Kim: have you considered studying sunbird bill and tongue structure?
Yes.
Could be an interesting comparison.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Thank you for that question. One of our PhD students is focused on sunbirds, and actually another one is focused on honey eaters. So we are now exploring all the continents to do the comparisons with these very similar, because they have convergently evolved to drink nectar, but very different systems, across the world. Yes, thank you.
From Ernie Hayden, fascinating and thank you. From a backyard hummingbird watcher, how shall we feed them?
I'm always convinced that providing flowers is the best way to do it. But of course, there are some species like the Anna's hummingbirds that are now here year round, that they are dependent on feeders too. As much as you can provide natural habitat and flowers, I would say do so. And if you do opt for having a feeder, then be as charismatic and dedicated as possible with it, in terms of cleaning it, in terms of changing the nectar often, and all that.
Right, good point. From Ann Kramer, watching the hummingbirds fight at the feeders I had in Southern California, they were often relentless and vicious, some species more than others. I heard that male hummingbirds will exhaust themselves to death fighting to protect a feeder. Is that true?
Sometimes. I have not witnessed this myself, but I have heard of anecdotes in which they do fight until one of them just cannot go any longer. But this is rare. Like usually they know when to stop and they just leave, like one of them leave, right? Like, and usually that's the most usual interaction. There's just a chase in which one is trying to bite or poke the other and the other one is just flying away.
Right. Okay, and here's an interesting question. Is there a difference in elasticity of the tongue in cold weather?
Huh, that is a great question. I actually don't have the answer to that. I do know that the nectar itself has some antifreezing properties and they keep the tongue very moist. I do not know if the efficiency changes, the extraction efficiency changes with temperature, but I would think so, actually. So that's a great question that we have not explored, and it would be fascinating too. So thank you for that.
From Matt Kirschbaum, question is, how does the concentration of 1 to 4 in backyard feeding compare to flowers in nature?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And in nature, it varies a lot. Usually, hummingbird pollinated plants have more dilute concentrations compared to insect pollinated plants. For instance, bee pollinated and butterfly pollinated. Well, butterfly is a little lower, but bee pollinated is more about around 35% or so. So 1 to 4 is more like 20%. And we're talking here about like, it's a measure that we take in bricks. We measure this with refractometers, taking the little nectar tube from the flower, like in the video, and then put it into a refractometer, and that gives you bricks. But yeah, it's like 1 to 4. So hummingbird plants are around 20%, and that's more or less what you find in feeders that are 1 to 4 ratio. So yeah, like other types of pollinators, like bats feed on more dilute nectar. That's more like 10% nectar. But hummingbirds would drink from more dilute nectar. It's just that they don't like it as much.
Right. Okay, let's see, lots more questions. Wow. Okay, from Jerry Eisner, what relationship to eating insects does the tongue have?
Yeah, that's a great question. So it is puzzling that hummingbirds can protrude the tongue that far, so they can extend the tongue really far outside of the bill. And that doesn't match with the nectar drinking. So one possibility is that they're using those flaps at the base of the tongue, the tongue wings, to move the insects that sometimes get stuck across the bill. So they stick the tongue out and then they just drag the insects back with the base of the tongue. But yeah, like it is still a mystery. Like why do hummingbirds have these not only long tongues, but that they can stick them so far out. And insects can be an answer to that.
Okay, Mary Selting's question is, how do hummingbirds here in the Northwest get enough nectar in the winter?
So the reason why Anna's hummingbirds, which is the one that is resident and can be here across the winter, is because of garden plants and feeders. So they have expanded their wintering range this far north because of humans, and that's how they manage to do it. It's just like human interaction. That being said, there are more and more natural resources that just because they are here now already, they are learning how to exploit and how to explore. But yeah, otherwise, yeah, they wouldn't be here.
Right. Okay, from Elaine, since the tongue is made of keratin and thus makes us draw the parallel with other keratin things which grow, since if the Hummer's tongue is injured somehow, damaged or broken, is it regrowable?
Yeah, that's an excellent point, and it actually is. So they are growing constantly, the tongues are growing constantly. So the same way that our nails grow, they have a growing region at the base of the tongue, and then just that structure continues to move forward. The reason why it's kept at the same length is the same reason why, you know, like in animals, they don't need to cut their nails because they wear them all the time. Mm-hmm. The hummingbirds are constantly wearing the tip of the tongues with the extruding process. So when they, the friction between the bill tips and the tongue keeps wearing off the tongue, and then the tongue keeps growing. And it's just, you know, through evolution, this reaches a balance in which the tongue is approximately the same length across the year.
Okay, from Bernard Hallett, in experiments, what sugar concentration is the hummingbird's favorite? I think you've answered this, but
Yeah, I mean, like, curiously, they do prefer it. So in experiments, they do prefer higher concentrations. So they do like more concentrated nectar up to a point. Like they don't like, you know, like 50, 40% is too much, but they do like slightly concentrated nectar.
Okay, from Jeff, do Anna's end up relying on winter feeders to the point that they will not make it if the feeders are not full?
Well, that depends on the flowers available. If the feeders are not around, that depends on like how many reserves they have. But they are pretty dependable of human resources. I don't know to which degree they could survive without any, you know, extra help from us, I would say. like I think without feeders, if they have still flowers, they would manage. But yeah.
Okay. From Adrian. I see. Are they phased, or I guess bothered by the wasps that try to share the sugar water? I've noticed that a lot at my feeders. And do they attack the wasps?
Yeah, I've seen both. I mean, I have not seen wasps fights that much, but I have seen bees fights a lot. So some hummingbirds get mad and try to bite the bees, and some bees get mad and try to, you know, like go after the hummingbirds. And the hummingbirds really freak out. Like when a bee goes after them, they hate it, and then they keep their distance. So there is this quarrel for the resource for sure, but it's usually, you know, they tolerate each other if it is not too bad. Like they quickly learn that the bees, for instance, quickly learn that hummingbirds sometimes are sloppy and start spraying it around, and they start licking it around.
Right. Okay, from Diane Jorgensen Quinn, does the heart beat in sync with the wings?
I do not think so. So the heartbeat has not been measured in depth. We're actually looking for funding to study heart functioning in hummingbirds in general. But the numbers of heartbeats are much higher than the numbers of wing beats usually. But yeah, like the core, like the heartbeat has only been studied like in like a couple of species, I want to say, and like very few individuals. And but we do know that there are wing beats, you know, like the range of wing beats is between, you know, like 20 hertz, like 20 times per second, so fairly slow, all the way to 100 hertz when they are like doing the displays and the mating dances when they really push themselves. So yeah, but I think that the hummingbird heart is something that is impressive and we don't know much about.
Very interesting. From Ernie Hayden, common tap water is normally used for the hummingbird feeder. However, tap water contains chlorine, fluoride, etc. Should we use distilled or purified water instead, or does it matter?
I don't think there has been any study showing that the tap water is bad for them. Their physiology, the digestive physiology, like water processing is, you know, like shared across vertebrates, well, terrestrial vertebrates. So probably, you know, to some degree, it's safe to assume that if it is not harmful for us, it would not be as harmful for them. But I don't have any data to support this claim. Like I would leave it as a question mark. Like, is it? We need to do experiments to see if, you know, if it is actually harming them or not. But so far I have not heard of any study that shows that it's harmful.
What do you use in your experiments? Do you use distilled water or do you use just tap water?
Because we do experiments in the lab and we want to know exactly the concentration of nectar that we use distilled water because just, you know, like we use like sucrose grade, like chemical concentration sucrose grade. So we don't want any traces of any other chemicals to know, you know, right. Other properties like viscosity and things like that, very constant. So we use distilled water, right. But that doesn't mean that is because of health concerns.
Is it true that annas rely more on insects than other hummers? From John Day.
That's a good question. All hummingbirds need arthropods. Actually, females rely more on spiders, for instance, during the breeding season mostly. All hummingbirds fly catch wasps, flies, many bugs. I don't have any reason to believe that annas would be like an exception across hummingbirds in terms of relying of insects. I just think that it could, you know, like eat different types of insects because it's adapted to more urban environments. So it would be eating whatever is available because the nectar is just carbohydrates. It's just giving them sugar and water. That's pretty much it. Even the one from the flowers, right? Like comparing, for instance, insect pollinated plants and hummingbird pollinated plants, the insects pollinated plants have more traces of vitamins and sometimes proteins in the nectar itself, but hummingbird pollinated plants lack all of that. So, and that's probably because they get all of that from the insects that they eat.
Cool. Okay, and to piggyback on the last question, this is from Ann Kramer. Does it make a difference what kind of sugar is used? I was told that CNH is cane sugar and generic brands use beet sugar and that hummers like the cane sugar. Is it a problem for their health if we use beet sugar?
So what we don't recommend is using like brown sugar or like honey or anything that is not as purified, just because those other compounds that are not as purified have higher loads of bacteria, and nectar is a great substrate for bacteria to grow, and the more bacteria that is in the nectar, the less hummingbirds like it, and the more harmful potentially for them. So yeah, I mean, like we use in the feeders. Experiments in the research station in Colombia, we just use purified cane sugar.
Okay, here's an interesting one from Yoon Lee. How do the hummingbirds' bones and organs survive the constant stress of their lifestyle? Is it common for hummingbirds to suffer injuries or broken bones from the lifelong physical stress?
That's a great question, and I don't think that it is common to have injuries in the bones, because let's say they break a wing, I think a hummingbird with a broken wing is done, like it wouldn't make it, it wouldn't survive. One time we captured a hummingbird that had the bill, the tip of the bill broken. And that was when we were studying fights in legs, which is like these reproductive assemblages. And then the next year we had this long-term monitoring study with bands. So the next year we caught the same individual and the bill tip was completely recovered and like if nothing what had happened. So they can regrow that perfectly, but again, no studies on bone regeneration done yet.
Lots of opportunities for study. Endless.
The more we know.
Okay, and what is from Nancy Crowell, and also kind of related from John Day, what's the average lifespan of a hummingbird, and specifically, how long do Anna's live and other species?
So from banding data, you know, like the usual time span that is common is, you know, like in the long range, 5 to 7 years, but in zoos and in captivity, hummingbirds have lived up to 12 or so years. So to be such tiny animals, that's a pretty long lifespan. And especially considering, you know, like their heartbeats, which is like 1200 times a minute, is pretty impressive that they live that long.
Well, it's an amazing study group of animals, because they're so fascinating, and so much we don't know about them. It looks like that's all the questions. So thank you so much. That was really, really fascinating. And we will post the recording in the next few days on our website and Facebook page. And there are many, many people giving you a thumbs up and thank yous. Many, many. Muchas gracias. So thank you so much. And with that, we'll let you go and hope that you continue to do some more wonderful research that we can learn about. So
yeah, absolutely. I'll keep you all posted. Thank you so much for inviting me, and thank you for the wonderful questions and suggestions.
Okay. Take care.
Okay.
Good night, everybody. Thanks.
Bye. Take care. Bye-bye.